Are you ready to create more engaging lessons that will empower your students and help them take more ownership of their learning? Are you wondering which teaching strategies or models might work best for you? Well, today I'm going to talk about the five top teaching strategies and models that can help enhance your science classroom and really get those students more engaged and more excited about science. First one I want to talk to you about is science stations. Now, science stations, there's lots of different types of science stations out there. You might see some science stations where there might be 5, 6, or 7 science stations for students to move around, or you could see some that only have 3 different stations to move around. The key concept of science stations is that at each station, students are doing an activity, usually either on their own or with a pair or with a group, and they are investigating the topic. They're learning about the topic. They're exploring the topic. Now, the science stations that I use are part of the blended learning model called the station rotation model. And with this one, there's 3 science stations. There's an online station, a group collaboration station, and a teacher-led station. And the idea of this is that in the online investigation, the students are doing some type of technology-based learning, whether that's an online lab or a research, or they're going onto and watching a video. It's something that the students are doing online using technology. With the group collaboration, they are working together. So usually the students all have different individual roles in the group and they are completing an activity. It could be a jigsaw activity. It could be that they are doing a hands-on investigation, but they're working together and discussing their ideas. Then in the teacher-led station, that's when the teacher has time for that individual small group instruction. If you're doing this during the explore phase of the 5E model, the teacher would still be kind of hands off, but just there to guide the student. Usually the station would be something that requires more complexity, more of the teacher observing the students to make sure that either that the equipment they're using or the chemicals they're mixing are being used properly. And then it could also be where the students are doing some really difficult reading or really difficult research, and the teacher needs there to give a little bit extra support than normally would happen. Now, if you're doing it during the elaborate phase, then this is where the teacher and that teacher-led station, it could actually be perfect for between the explain and the elaborate phase, where the students that need that extra support can stay within that explain stage, and the teacher can then give them extra clarification and review that information. And then when they have the group that understands it and is ready to apply, they can then take them to the next level, give them a little bit more difficult, higher level task to work on, and again, give them the support that they need. The second strategy is the flipped classroom model. Now, with the flipped classroom model, instead of giving the students notes in class, usually through a lecture of some sort, a presentation where they're taking notes in class, the students go home and watch a video. So all that information you would have had on your presentation, you will then convert to a video, and the students then watch the video to take their notes. Now, the benefit of this is that the students can pause the video, they can rewind the video, and they can go at their own pace, so they're not missing any of the information. You can go through your presentation just like you would and record it in a screen recording, so the students get to hear your voice, they can read off the screen on their video, and they can get everything that they would have gotten in class, but this time, again, they get to go at their own pace. So if they need to pause that video to write down that information and then play it again and listen to you explain it, they can do that. If they want to just go quickly through it, they can do that. If they need to listen to it one more time or a few more times, they can do that. And before a test, they can watch it again. So instead of students getting half the notes or some of the notes or missing some important information because they either checked out and did a little daydreaming for a while you were giving your lecture, or they were having trouble processing the information or translating the information and it was taking them longer, so they didn't quite get it all. Instead, your students have it all. They come in prepared. They've got all that basic information. They are more confident because they have all that information and they're able to now apply it. They're not going home and now practicing with only half the information and still completely confused because they didn't really get the lecture notes, all of them, the way they were supposed to. Now they have all those lecture notes and all that practicing is done in the classroom with the support from you and other fellow students. So this allows for, again, more time in class to do those activities, to have that small group instruction, to get those students doing more investigations, to build those relationships. So that's the flipped classroom model. The third one is choice boards. Now, choice boards, this allows the students to take more ownership of their learning because they are choosing what they're going to either learn, create, or produce. In choice boards, the students are given different options. There are many different types of choice boards. Some of them are 9 different choices to choose from and they do a tic-tac-toe. Sometimes you could have a list of items to choose from, a menu choice where they make like a 3-course meal by choosing different items in the different courses, like an appetizers, a main course, and a dessert, and they have different items to choose from in each one. But this allows the students to choose how they want to present that information, show you what they learned, or they can choose maybe different topics that they want to go deeper into. So for example, if you're doing Newton's laws, maybe your choice board is different sports, and you have 10 different sports the students can research about to learn Newton's laws. That would be a way to bring in the students' interests. So again, different ideas for the choice board. Something I do recommend with choice boards is that you have one rubric for all the grading. So that it doesn't matter what the students choose to work on, what they choose to create, produce, or learn about, that there is only one rubric that you use for grading everything. Also keep in mind that you don't necessarily need to know how to do all those things. What you do need to be able to do is guide the students in their own learning of how to do it. So if they want to do an infographic, show them where they can create an infographic, like using Canva, how they can take a template and then modify it. And you can just pull up YouTube videos to help them or show them how to go to YouTube and find a video that will help them out. That's even better. Instead of you learning all the stuff and then giving that to the students, teach the students how they can Google it and YouTube it to find the information, to find how to do things. So that's number 3, choice boards. Number 4, inquiry investigations. Most of our labs that we have in our textbooks and our activities are very guided step by step, and that's fine. They can do those guided inquiries where they are going step by step, and sometimes students need that. They still should be looking at the information themselves, analyze it, and drawing their own conclusions. So it's okay to have a guided inquiry where you are taking them through how to do it, but allow them to process the information. So instead of you taking them through what they should be seeing and taking them through how to look at the data and analyze it and draw those conclusions, and you are showing them what they should be observing and showing them and telling them what they should have learned in that little investigation, have them instead come up with their own ideas. A better way, though, if you really want to get into inquiry investigations, is to turn that guided reading into a true inquiry, where instead you just give them a question, a big overall question, give them different materials, and then let them figure out how they're going to create an experiment to test that question. You can give them prompting questions like, variable will you keep the same? What variable are you going to change? How are you going to measure this? What data will you collect? So those are fine, and that's perfect, as you know, giving them those kind of prompting questions, but allow them to create the experiment. That's where you can go from a guided inquiry to a non-guided inquiry, where students are actually, you know, taking even more ownership of their learning, because now they have to actually create the investigation. They have to figure out what they're going to manipulate, which materials they're going to use, how they're going to gather that data, and then they're going to have to observe the data, analyze it, and draw their conclusions from that. So that's number four, inquiry investigations. Finally, our fifth strategy for making more engaging lessons that empower your student is to have them do engineering design projects. So in an engineering design project, they have to go through the whole engineering design process where they are going to brainstorm, they're going to research, they're going to create a prototype, they're going to test the prototype, they're going to modify the prototype, they're going to test it again, they might modify it again, and they will keep repeating that until they have the product that they feel is going to solve that problem. This is great, especially for like your forces units, your motion units. So you could have them create a car that uses Newton's third law to move, but have that car also hold an egg where they have to create a safety system for that egg, which is going to represent a human, and then have those cars collide either into a wall or collide into each other. So they have to move by Newton's third law. They cannot just, you know, push them. To move by Newton's third law, they have to have that egg, and that egg has to be secured in place so that way when it does collide into another car or a wall, that nothing happens to the egg. This will require them to research seatbelts, safety precautions, maybe crumple zones. They could do online investigations on this. They'll also have to research how to actually create their car so they can look at what have other people done, how they've solved this problem. So having them really create an engineering design project where they're going through the whole entire step gets the students more excited about science. It gets them more engaged about science. They're learning, they're applying, and they're using a lot of their creativity. So those are my five strategies and methods for creating more engaging lessons that empower your students. Again, science stations, flipped classroom, choice boards, inquiry investigations, and the engineering design projects.
Thank you for watching another Adventures in iSTEM and Beyond video. Don't forget to subscribe and turn on notifications for more Adventures in iSTEM and Beyond videos. For more ideas on how to incorporate science, technology, and skills for life into your classroom, go to adventuresinistem.com.